I've flipped through a couple of times. I think it comes on FX the other night or something like that. But it's about this help me, it's this virus that gets loose. You know, and it's a typical, you know, virus thing where everybody gets infected. But with this one, if you get infected with the virus, you become a zombie. And then these zombies run around trying to bite everybody. And you get bitten, you turn into a zombie and all this. And the hero of the thing is the woman, and she has been shot. And y'all seen this one. Anyway, so now we own this thing about there's this resident evil within us. And so what do we do? What are we to do? I mean, the same principle still applies. If evil is out there, or if it's in here, you still have to kill it. I'm not saying you go on and give yourself. That's the question. Hang with me. So what are we to do? So put to death the sinful earthly things working within you. Colossians 3. Put to death the sinful, evil things, earthly things working within you. I'm not making this stuff up, folks. It's in the Bible. Listen to what the whole verse says. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. Sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Isn't that the root of all evil is idolatry? We put other things above God. We put these things that we pursue, this sinful stuff, we put it ahead of God. That makes it an idol. An idol is anything we worship over God. Our struggle then is ultimately is not against the devil. You think that through. We always say that he's our problem. You know, Satan's our problem. He's the enemy number one. That's where the problem is. It's all his fault. Our problem is not Satan. Our problem is our own heart. Because if our heart wouldn't listen to him, we'd be okay. Remember, he's the great deceiver. It's when our heart is listened to him that we have a problem. And if there wasn't something within us that wanted to listen, we'd be okay. It's still there. You remember Eve? Did God really say, "Ooh, you got my attention now"? Did God really say that? You see how that continues? And it's not just you. Listen to Paul. I love this passage from Romans because it makes me feel better about myself. Romans chapter 7. You got your Bibles, and I hope you brought your Bibles. Y'all ought to know by now. But I want you to look and read and follow along with me. Romans chapter 7. Listen to this. We're going to pick up in verse 18. Am I going to start giving out a wine box for everybody to bring the Bible? Alright. Romans chapter 7. Verse 18, I want to read it from the New Living Translation because this is one of those that you got to get tongue tied on, or at least I've been in reading this passage. And a lot of you don't know what I'm talking about when I read it, you're familiar with it. Paul writes, "And I know that nothing good lives in me. That is, in my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't." Anybody else? Anybody else go there? I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what's wrong, but I do it anyway. If I do what I don't want to do, I'm really the one doing wrong. I am not really the one doing wrong. It's sin living in me that does it. Anybody relate to that? You try and try and try, and you fail and fail and fail. I have discovered this principle of life, right? That when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart. I love the Ten Commandments.
but you keep trying, you want to do what's right, you know what the law says. Well, that's why I say the law, you know what God's word says, and you really try hard. But the sin, because it still lives in you, you just keep failing. And so you fall. What am I to do? I'm the wretch that amazing grace was written for. What am I to do? Oh, what a miserable person I am, he writes.
Romans chapter 7. Turn there. You're going to be here a little while. Romans 7 and 8. Because the next verse says, thanks be to God for Jesus Christ, our Lord. Verse 25. Thanks be to God. And then he goes on, Romans 8, 1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. So if I paint a kind of a gloomy picture for you, Jesus, right today, is no longer gloomy. The clouds part, the sun comes out. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. So we're no longer condemned. What the law says. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. The Bible says the consequence of our sin is death. Because ain't that what we've been telling you? That you have to kill it? Because the consequences of sin ultimately is death. Because when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, we no longer had eternal life. And now the wages of sin is death. The consequences of our sin. But Jesus set us free from that. So in this battle for the mortification of sin, if God is for us, who can be against us? We've been freed from the consequences of sin. Eternal judgment in hell, we've been freed from that. But the battle rages on. Those of us who are in Christ, we've been delivered from the consequences of our sin. We no longer face eternal judgment and damnation. So the battle is still there. We still fight against the sin that the nature that lives in us. We've been freed from the consequences of sin, but the struggle is still there. The struggle is still there. Our redemption is sure, but the fight goes on. We still have to fight. One writer said,